Howdy. Beautiful Saturday, unless you live in Cuba or the Keys. I'm like addicted to following this hurricane. Of course, I got family, you know, all over Florida, Georgia. But I hate it for everybody. I wish they didn't exist. Either way, I wanted to talk to you about a question I got today that I thought was a good question. This one came in on YouTube, and I'm going to share it with you so you can see it. It's publicly posted, so I don't have to ask for permission. Yeah, you should be able to see that. Now, what I'll do is I'm going to make this like this so you can see it. Then I actually have to go to it. All right. It says, thank you very much for your helpful. I love your videos. It's sort of making me shift my focus from wholesale drink distribution, my current business, to making my own hot dog cart business. The one thing I'm having a tough time is believing my numbers, the potential, especially in Fort Lauderdale, where I live, seems too lucrative. Is there a ratio to the percentage? Here's the question. Is there a ratio to the percentage of foot traffic that will buy a hot dog? For example, will 1% of people who walk past my cart, will they buy a hot dog cart or a cart, you know, a hot dog or a meal or something? Right now, I think my volume estimates may be too high. I want to estimate what I can expect for sales in the business. Thank you very much. I love your videos. And then he's got some tips, and I'll read those for you in just a second. But I want to address this first. I want to address this part first. Is it's a great question. You know, I've been doing this a long time. I think I've been on the podcast for 7 or 8 years now, and I don't think that I've ever gotten this question. Like, what percentage of walk-by traffic is going to stop for a hot dog? I've never looked at it like that. I always looked at, is there a lot of traffic flow? Well, that's a good spot. Well, my best answer, and my answer to this person over on the YouTube comments, was it's a guess at best. You could guess. I would say, I mean, literally, I would say 1 in 20. Well, that's 5%, right? So is 5% accurate? I don't know. You know, if you've got walk-by traffic and you're in front of the landfill and it smells like crap, then no, it probably isn't going to be good. Or if you've got two porta-potties, you know, one on each side of you, probably not going to be too good. Doesn't matter how many people walk by. So I think it comes down to just getting to a place where you have good traffic, good walk by traffic. I always like walk by better. You've heard me say better than, you know, drive by. Drive by, you got to stop them. They're going, you know, between points A and B that didn't factor in on an A and a half. You know, and swerving in to get something. And the trick would be too, is the walk by traffic during those peak times where you need it to be. You know, I would want to be there between 11 and 1. I'd want to see how many people come through there. We had the vendor I told y'all about the other day that put up the game camera. I thought it was brilliant. He put up a game camera in town. And it's camouflaged, and so you don't even notice it. And he watched how much traffic was on this place. Well, he ended up getting that spot. Since I posted that, he went ahead and did it. I thought it was brilliant. So I wonder if there is a percentage that you could average with. I don't think there is. I think it'd be like guessing where the next hurricane's going to hit in 2018. I think it'd just be mind-numbingly idiotic to guess. I know that if you're there between these hours, 11 and 1, okay, And I'm not talking about your night crowds, your bar crowds. I'm talking about your 11 to 1 lunchtime. That's when people are looking for their lunch, quick lunch, so they can check their Twitter and their Facebook and their Snapchats. So if you are located in a location where there's a lot of people going by, I think that you could accomplish what you want and get no matter what, as long as you had plenty of traffic. The percentages, I mean, honestly, and I told him this, I've heard of vendors that did good in bad places. Like, I've talked to vendors. And then I've also talked to vendors who did crappy in good locations. We had a vendor recently that, you know, he's in our Vendors United group. And for the last few months, he's been at, like, if you'd have picked a location and said, what do you think? I'd have said, oh, yes, this is going to do it. No worries. He had the perfect setup. Sent me video, sent me pictures. He struggled for months. It wasn't the location, really. It was the menu. It turned out it was the freaking menu. That's what changed it. We tweaked the menu. Sales went up. And not just a little up. I'm talking like quadrupled up. So that's there's so many little things that affect a location. And so you could be dressed in a white t-shirt, you know, with tobacco stains down the front and look like you ain't had a bath in 3 days. And you're probably not going to do good, even if it's a good location. But all those things aside, the perfect setup, the right signage, the right, you know, your signs are big enough they can read without asking you how much this is. All that stuff, if you have that stuff, then if you have a consistent amount of traffic going by you in a 2 hour period, you should kick butt. General rule of thumb. I know that's not a concrete answer, and that's because this business ain't concrete. Here's some tips, though. I thought this was cool that he'd share this publicly. He goes, idea for a new video, Ben. Mobile ATMs. And I know they exist. You know, you may want security to do it, but you're a mobile ATM. They swipe their card, you give them their cash, you charge them a fee. Great for events and stuff. How about selling Jamaican style beef patties, cheap, high margins, and all you need is a patty warmer? This idea has been popular in New York City, and I love, yeah, honestly, I've never tried it. I can tell you, I wouldn't know. It sounds good. I like Jamaican jerk seasoning and I like Jamaican food. So, what you making? If that wasn't corny enough. So I think that you could, I think you could do that. If the Jamaican burgers are able to be held in a water bath, like, a beef au jus. Okay. And kept at temperature, then yeah. But I check your codes first. And I know Florida has some strict codes. So could you do it at an event? Yes. Could you do it catering? Yes. Could you do it on the street? No, not in Florida. And you told me you were in Florida. So I know that's not a possibility. Let me see who's here real quick. That was all I had for you, by the way. Troy's in the house. Thanks for being here, Troy. Berto and Liz. Al. Yeah, diggity dogs. All right, Anthony is here. Hey, Anthony. Glad you're here. Dolan's here. Joseph is here. Route 66 hot dogs. You know, as I call out these names, you should be following these people. Not so they get street credit, although that is a side benefit. Okay, they get more likes and everything. You get to pick up tips. They may have a tip that you wouldn't use in a million years, but that tip inspires something in your head and you go, oh my gosh, that's a great idea. Let's see. Shane's here. Thanks for being here, Shane. Troy, I thought it was 30%. I don't think it's 30%, Troy. I've been in locations personally that had lots of walk by traffic and didn't do 30% or nowhere near that. I might have pulled 2%, but it was 2% enough. You know, it was like 2% milk, still tastes kind of like milk, a little watered down, but let's see. Denver's in the house. Aaron's here. I don't know if y'all saw Aaron's post. If you want to, Aaron helped me create my first ever lettuce wrapped hot dog. It was freaking delicious, and I've eaten them, I don't want to lie to you, 3 or 4 times since. I know a minimum of 3, could have been 4 times since. Love them. I watch my carbs, see. A mobile, or I pick my carbs. Don't really watch them. Like, I save them up for biscuits and gravy. I save carbs up for triple batter, you know, chicken strips that I make. Or I save them up for Oreos. Guilty pleasures, right? And I save up a little bit of calories for bourbon. Amanda's in the house. EJ, a mobile ATM. EJ, I'm telling you, I've heard of people doing it. I never considered it as another benefit of the cart. You're in front of people in an event and you've got money there that you're cashing out for people. The only thing I see as a risk is people know, oh, I'm a mobile ATM. That means I have cash. And so there could be a safety issue, but, you know, probably in a closed event, you're probably all right. Amanda, thanks for being here. Troy, Ron's here. Thanks for being here, Ron. Ron Curtis. So I always loved his, he's had that same profile for a long, long time, and I love it. Anyway, that was it. That was it. I hope that helped you. Do you have any questions while you're here? We got about 20 people here, 19, 20 people. Unless mine's delayed and yours is better than mine. But if you got a question, Robert's in the house. Robert from Texas. Hopefully you're not from the part that just got inundated with water. All right. Michael is here. Michael. Oh, let me tell y'all something. This is a public service announcement. Got an email today. I use something called LastPass. LastPass. Okay. And it just saves passwords and stuff. Well, they sent me an email today and said, hey, did you know that that Equifax, you know, the credit, one of the three giant credit bureaus, got hacked, and somewhere in the 150 million people's info got stolen. So I go to Equifax, and I'm not like, I don't subscribe to anything from them or anything. They just keep up with my credit, right? They give you points or something. So I go to their page, and they have a warning and a letter from their CEO or a video from their CEO. And I click, and it says, check to see if your information was compromised. So you put in your last 6 digits of your social and your last name, and you check. Bam, I was compromised. Means they got, here's what they got: your social, your date of birth, every credit card you own and credit card number, bank account. They got it all, right? 150 roughly million people affected by this in the U.S. 150 million, that's half the country. So every time you see 2 people, know one of them got their information jacked. Now they're trying to do preemptive things to put in place, and that's why they have this page up, and then they give you the preemptive things you can do. But the bottom line is, little public service announcement, check it. Go to Equifax, and you'll see a link there that you can check yours to see if your information has been jacked. I'd like for the people that did that to Equifax, which I don't like Equifax. I think all those people are scum, but I don't like them having access to the personal information, your credit information. Somebody could do, what is that called when you, fake identity thing, you duplicate somebody's identity. Well, I don't want somebody to duplicate my identity. I think I'm good enough for good looking enough for both of us. Would dry creamer give you the same taste as half and half in Italian sodas? I do not know, Troy. That's a great question. Jimmy in the house. Jimmy, D.C. Well, Maryland, but D.C. Maryland, D.C. It's all right there together. With the ease of use of CCs and Square, why mess with an ATM? You don't have to mess with the ATM. You are the ATM, Mark. So you are the ATM for people that need cash at an event or something. Because some vendors still don't take it. They just don't take cards. So you have to give them cash. Let's see. By clicking to check on whether or not you were compromised, you also gave up your right to sue Equifax. It's in a very small print. Yes. They actually came out a thing about that. The actual president did and sent out a letter. And I think it was NBC or ABC put out a letter today that said that was incorrect. You didn't give up your rights and you did not have to follow their arbitration rules. This is covered. You're protected under the FTC, the Federal Trade Commission, their banking division. No, you can be part of a class action suit. You can do whatever you want. On the Italian sodas, no, it won't. I wasn't following that at all, but just a little bit with the putting creamer. I here's what I would do. I'd try it. I wouldn't try it on my cart to the public. I'd try it at home, see what taste is, have some friends and family taste it and see. Kind of like how we pick hot dogs to serve. We kind of do the same kind of deal. All right. I think we're done. Anyway, I appreciate you being here. Hope you have a good, what is it? Saturday night. Have a great Saturday night. And I'll see you maybe tomorrow or maybe Monday, Tuesday. Who knows? The Mark asked, let me see if I can get that to pull up. Yeah. Any word on Snapdogs doing a deal with VU? No. The only word I have, Scott, great question. I'll get to it in just a second. Any word on Snapdogs, the deal with Snapdogs, that guy's like a one-legged man in a butt-kicking contest. His dogs are good. A lot of people are wanting them. He doesn't know distribution isn't in place. And the big distributors, the Ciscos and all those, aren't stocking them yet. So until they're stocking them, or till your broadline distributors are stocking them, it makes it harder to get. Now, he'll help you, but until that's in place, there's no real substantial way to get those at a good enough price. It's kind of like my favorite dog, you know, the Zweigels dogs from up New York or something. Yeah, New York. They're delicious. They're too freaking expensive, expensive to ship. Look at the hot dog patties, the actual hamburger patties that are hot dogs. They're perfect. They boil, they steam, they grill. If you didn't see that video, you need to be knocked in the head. They're awesome, right? They taste, it's exactly a hot dog, just sliced and big, like slider dogs. Well, they're the same way. Expensive as heck for shipping. Not worth it. Scott says, how many people take cards at the stands? Don't know. I don't know how many vendors we've been pitching it to vendors, teaching vendors for about 5 years. We've tried about every system out there, from PayPal to Intuit to, which is QuickBooks, to some Johnny Come Latelys, to some that are just for straight food vending, to everything, and Square has beat them all. In fact, today I put up Square. I set up an account for my daughter who is starting the Pig Roaster Pro, the Roasting Nomad Tribe. Roastingnomad.com, if you want to know about that. Roastingnomad.com. She is doing that, my youngest of seven daughters. And I set up her Square account today because she was at work. And I'm excited about it. Square's got so many new features. You can order ahead. You've got so many cool things you can do with Square. And it's not a perfect system, but it's by far the best we've tried. And I promise you, between Jason, I, Corey, John, Rick, Tammy, and Debbie, I bet we've tried 25 platforms consistently for like months. And Square still beats it all. I hope that helps. I'll talk to y'all later.